Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Let's try that one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's better. Almost sounds like you're awake. It's good to see you this morning. So here's what I know. By the way, that's the first time I've ever shown Charlie and the Chocolate Factory on Easter. That's got to be a first. So, but here's what I know about you and about me. When we watch that movie, we root for Charlie. Because we think, how could you not know that being honest is the best thing? How could you not know that owning up is the best thing? How could you think that saying, I'm going to get even with you, whatever it takes, is a good thing? And so we tend to look at Grandpa, or as some of us know him, Chico and the Man. And if you know that, if you don't know that, kids, Google it later. Chico, don't be discouraged. If you need any songs from theme shows from the 70s or 80s, I can help you out. I even know every commercial jingle. But anyway, way too much TV as a child. It's okay. So we watch that video, though, and we see it, and we think, you know, how could you not root for Charlie? But here's the truth about you and about me. It is great to look at somebody else and say, gosh, if they could only be honest. If they only realized where they were at and what's going on, how much it would help them just to own it. Just to own, hey, I blew it, I messed up. And how big of a difference it would make it in their life if they could just say, I was wrong, like Fonzie couldn't say, right? Wrong. And so many of us look, and in the movies we say, that's great, but in our own lives we don't like to admit that we failed or that we've blown or that we had any part in our failure. And here's what I want you to know. We're going to look today at Luke chapter 23 and John chapter 20, and we're going to look at three different people and how they responded to Christ, because here's the deal. For you and for me. Just like the sands in the hourglass. I know that sounds like a TV show. Soap opera. So are the days of our lives. Like dust in the wind, said Bill and Ted, right? So as the sand goes through, but here's the truth about you and about me. These, just like an hourglass, these are the moments in our lives that sand represents. And today what we're going to do is we're just going to stop time for just a moment. We're going to look at how one decision, how one time of owning it, of saying this is where it's at, of recognizing who Jesus is, or recognizing that I don't have it together, or taking a moment just to say, you know what, I've failed, I've messed up. Just that moment can change every moment that comes behind it. Because for some of you right now, the moments that are happening even now have been impacted because at some point in the past, there was a moment in the past where someone hurt you, or where you failed, or you messed up, and because of that, now you're bitter, or you're perplexed, or you're frustrated, or you feel like a failure, or you're walking in shame, or you're busy blaming other people, and that one moment that happened is now impacting everything that's coming, and because of your past, you now are impacting everything in the moment. And I want you to know something, though. We have a God that in the moment can change everything. And that means today, while you're sitting here, you can make a decision in a moment that can change everything that follows, everything in your life that happens next, because you decide to forgive, or you decide to receive forgiveness from God, or you decide to quit trying to blame other people and just own it and say, okay, this is my part of the mistake. And instead of just looking at what somebody did, you begin to look forward. Maybe today for you, the thing that's going to change in the moment is that even though somebody hurt you in the past and you couldn't do a thing about it and you didn't do anything wrong, you choose in this moment to forgive that person, and so that you can move forward, so that your next moments may be even better than your past. The moments that are coming up could be where you learn to love and care for people and have joy and peace like you've never had, because you've been walking in stress and blame and hurt and failure, and instead you can begin to walk in gratitude and thanksgiving and joy. And the rest of your life, the rest of these moments can be better than these. And for those of you who give your lives to Christ, the moments don't end here. They go forward in eternity. And one moment can make a difference. Now, when we look at Charlie, we say, gosh, that's how I am. We all think that we're that person who owns up. But let's be honest. No. No, you're not. You're not. You're a liar. Bunch of liars. You're a bunch of... How many of you own up very easily when you do something wrong? You're like instantly, oh, I did wrong. I did wrong. Yeah, I don't like you. Okay, so... No, because most of us, what happens? You know, we have a performance review and our boss brings us in and they tell us 20 things we did well and one thing we did bad. And what do we remember? The one thing we did bad. So what do? We push back. I can't believe they never say that. 400 things go right. One thing goes wrong. We can't believe that ever happened, right? And instead of walking in gratitude and instead of saying, you know what? I own it. I messed up. I blew it. We look and we try to blame someone else for our problem. So here it is. Number one. We focus, the reason we don't, is because we focus on the mistakes of others. That is my favorite thing to do. By the way, all four of these, I do every one of these. Everyone, I do them all. I blame other people. I'm just like Adam in the Bible. Great, starts out, first story in the Bible, thousands of years ago, okay? And by the way, this is one of the stories that I'd say, you know, this is where I know the Bible's accurate, because God comes to Adam and says, hey, dude, you ate the fruit. By the way, it doesn't say apple, but anyway, you ate the fruit. And Adam says, well, you know what, God? That woman, you gave her to me, and she's the one. So you and her need to get together, straighten it out. He didn't really say that, but that's kind of his attitude. Like, he blames God for his problems. Been there? No, God, you made me with ADD. It's your fault that the sermon was really bad, right? You don't say that? Number two, it's your fault that I blurted that in the middle of the thing, right? Number two, we think we can change. What did I say? We think we can't change. Would you read your notes? We think we can't change or don't want to change. You know what this is? This is Popeye syndrome. Do you remember Popeye? Right? So what would Popeye say? I am what I am. And there's people like that. Like, I'm just the grumpy person. I'm just the gossip. I'm just the mean person. Listen, don't ever just that to God, because you have a God that's much greater than your just that. Number three, we've been hurt when we tried to make things right. Everybody's had this happen. You went to make something right, you tried to fix it, and you walked away madder than you were before you started. Like, I'll never do that again. You know, I tried to help in church one time, and those people weren't grateful. Yeah, welcome to church. I'm the pastor. It happens to me all the time, right? And somebody came to me this morning and said, hey, I'm bringing a friend, and last time they came to church, the pastor, something happened. And I'm like, great. I'm going to make it worse today. They're just going to go downhill. The pressure's on. Number four, it's painful to admit we're wrong. It's painful. It's shameful. It's like, I blew it again. I did something dumb again. Hopefully they didn't see me drive through that traffic light, right? Everything, right? All right. So how do we respond to failure and hurt? I want to look at the cross, and I want to look at the story that happens in Luke chapter 23, because there's two thieves. By the way, there may have been a bunch of crosses, but we look at two. One responds one way, and one responds the other, and I honestly think that's our options. Here we go. Number one. We can focus on our pain and blame other people. Some of you can't even listen to me this morning because somebody hurt you and that's all you can think about. They might be sitting in this room and you're sitting across the room going, I can't believe so-and-so's here. They call themselves a Christian? You know? Somebody came to me recently and said, if I come to church, the walls are going to fall down. I'm like, no. You don't know who our drummer is. If the walls were going to fall. By the way, for those of you who think I'm being mean to Bob, I am. It's absolutely true, because he's one of my favorite people on earth. So there you go. So one of the criminals who hung there, listen to this, hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. Now realize that Jesus had been beaten. They put a crown of thorn in his head. After they put the crown of thorn in his head, the Bible says that they even took the staff and hit him on the head while the crown of thorns was on there. They beat him. I mean, listen, all of these people are in pain, but Jesus is in the most pain. And not only is he in pain, the Bible here says he hurled insults. Those two words in the Greek, it's where we get the idea of blaspheme, but it literally means to injure somebody with your words. You ever been injured by somebody's words? Most of you, when I say that, can think of a time, maybe when you were a kid, maybe when you were in school, maybe when you were at home, where somebody said something to you and it was like a knife. You just knew it. And you may even still believe what they said today. I want you to know, don't let somebody's insults make you believe that. This thief was looking at Jesus and saying, hey, I'm in pain. You say you're God and you are doing nothing. I think we've all felt that way sometimes. You know, God, I don't know where you are. God, if you're God, why don't you answer the way I want you to? If you're like me, you're even more blunt. I'm like, God, I had this plan for my life, and you haven't really carried it out, so can I just give you my plan, and you do it? Because your plan I don't like so much. So can you do the easy one? I've got the easy one. So here you go. But God never takes my plan. I hand it to him. He hands it back. I tell him instead of refiner's fire, I'd like refiner's jacuzzi. So I, you know, here you go, God. I'd like it easy. And, you know, you could just have me win the lottery. Even though I don't buy a ticket, I'll just find one. Right? You've got this whole plan for God and everything's going to go well. But life never works out this way. And when it doesn't, so often it's easy to say, God, you've hurt me. You failed me. Things didn't go the way I want to. Where are you? Or the second thing we can do. We can own our part in the hurt and ask for help. Unless you've been abused. Abuse you don't have a fault in. Unless you've been through abuse, when something happens, there's almost always a part, something you could have done better, and it's important to own that part. And all of us have had a time in our life when we failed or we faltered, and we need to own it and say, you know what, I just really blew it there. Listen to this. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you're under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. So this criminal looks at the other criminal and he says, listen, and they're hanging on a cross. This is the part that kind of goes, the most painful death in the world. And he says, we deserve this. But this man doesn't. And then he continues. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. So at that point, he admits he's God. So he admits he's failed. And then he admits he's God. And then Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you'll be with me in paradise. This is the gobstopper moment. It's the moment that this thief on the cross had nothing to give, nothing to do, nothing he could do. He couldn't even get baptized. He couldn't do anything because it's not by works that you're saved. You're saved through faith in Jesus. And all he did was say, I don't have anything. I messed up, but would you remember me? And Jesus said, you've won. You've won. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. That's the hope of grace and why we're here today. Charles Stanley said this in his latest book. After brokenness, our lives can be more fruitful, more purposeful, and more joyful. A genuine blessing can come in the wake of being broken. You know what Charles Stanley's saying? He's saying in that moment when life falls apart. 20 years ago, Charles Stanley went through a terrible divorce. His church tried to fire him. His son left the ministry. A lot of the church members left. The deacons came after him, and he stayed where he was at. And today, at 80, whatever years old, he's still preaching. And I'll be honest with you, some of the best preaching I've ever heard is still there. He sits down to preach the whole time. He has a hard time standing the whole time. But the words that come out, why? Because God used that moment of difficulty and of challenge and what everyone else would say, look at that failure. And that moment made him more honest and more caring and more real and more loving. And the rest of the moments, God is using that brokenness. He can do that in you, regardless of what's happened in your past, if you'll make that choice in the moment. So let's look at how we can do that. How can we make better choices? First, you got to realize where you're at. I had somebody say this week, I heard this in a thing I was watching, they said, how does a fish know it's wet? Does a fish even know it's alive? Right? How does a fish know? The idea was, how do we know where we're at? Some of us have no idea where we're at spiritually. We don't even, you ask an angry person, if they're angry, they'll look at you and go, I'm not angry. You ever had that happen? Did you know that grumpy person in your neighborhood that yells at all the children? And hopefully they're not next to you. Don't look at them. Okay? That grumpy person in your neighborhood that yells at the children. Did you know they don't know they're grumpy? They don't realize they're a jerk? Nobody says, you know, I am a jerk. It's awesome, right? And all of us, how many of you know a jerk? You know a jerk? Anybody in here? You don't know a jerk? If you don't know a jerk, you're the one. So let me ask that again, all right? So, how many of you know a jerk? Oh, much better response that time. Okay, that's good. Hey, you kept your hand down. I'm not sure why. Okay, so, I'm just giving them a hard time. All right, so the truth is, a lot of times we don't know, and it makes me think, when I was in high school, and teachers are going to hate this story, so if you're a teacher, just forgive me ahead of time. So when I was in high school, I had this science teacher. He was a great teacher, but he was so boring. I mean, he made Ferris Bueller's teacher look interesting. I mean, Brookins. I think he sold Visine. You know, I'm not sure what he did against the Red Out. I'm not sure what he did. But we'd be in class, I mean, you're trying to stay awake and you're taking notes. He's giving notes.
And today, as we talk about the scientific principle,
as I'm sitting there, I'm a little ADD for those of you who don't know it. And if you don't believe in ADD, then sorry. So I'm hyper, whatever. Okay, so the ballast in the light bulb is making noise. Just that light, you know what I'm talking about? The noise. And so I decided I was bored, so I would match that pitch. So as I sat there, Bueller, I go. He starts walking towards me and looking at me and looking up. Looking at me and looking up. And here's what's awesome. Two of my friends were sitting here and one was at the next aisle. When he came down, I stopped and my friend in the middle started. And so he comes walking, he's looking at me, and he goes, as he gets close to me, he can realize, I'm like, hey. And he's like, oh. So he walks over towards my friend. As he gets over here, he's looking at the ballast, he's looking at my friend, and he stops, and here's what's awesome. My third friend starts in. So he's all the way over here now. And he starts walking towards this guy. And then guess what? I started again, all the way over here. He looks at the light, he looks down, he says, I thought I heard something. He kind of walks off like defeated. I don't know that he did that, but I did that. But he didn't do that. He was so mellow that he probably walked off like this.
And then we're talking about the sign there.
Well, as he walked off, though, it was hard for me not to go. Because that would have been a weird ballast. That ballast would have been awkward. But here's the thing, he couldn't find it. He couldn't figure out where it was coming from. He didn't know where that noise was from. And any of you who've ever gotten a cricket in your house, you know exactly what I'm talking about. How many of you have ever gotten a cricket in your house? Yes, right? And I just want you to know something about my house. When a cricket gets in my house, it is the longest living cricket ever in the history of crickets. And it can hide. There's no way. And you're looking around, you're like, it's over here. No, it's over there. No, it's over here, right? And you're looking. Some of us are like that with our own lives. There's something that's obvious to everyone except us because we've never come to the point that we own it. And what do we not own? Number one, we don't own our emotions. We must own our... I got tired from that story. I need to take a breath. Wait. Okay, that's much better. Okay, sorry. You guys start doing that, you're in trouble. All right, so you all get a detention. I'll keep you all late. Okay, anyway. All right. That was awesome. He walks out. Okay, that was great. All right. I don't blame you. I believe too. All right. Sorry. He's like, I will never come to this church again. All right. So we must own our emotions to see clearly. Mary stood outside the tomb. This is Mary Magdalene. Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look at the tomb. Listen, she saw two angels dressed in white. Now, at this point, if you had heard all through Jesus' ministry, I will rise again after 3 days. You saw Jesus on the cross. You're looking in the grave. Now there's angels. There's a shroud of Turin or whatever it is, folded up. It wasn't called that back then. Anyway, so everything's folded up, and you look in, and here's what she says. I love this. One at the head, the other at the foot. They asked her, woman, why are you crying? Which is awesome, because let me tell you something. The angels knew, unlike all men, the angels knew why she was crying. I'm in a lot of trouble. My sister-in-law is looking at me like, hey, we're having lunch today? Your food's not going to be good. All right, so you know, woman, why are you crying? Which is awesome, okay? Woman, why are you crying? And then she said, they know why. They've taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they put him. Now the stone is rolled away. There's tombs that have been opened. There was an earthquake last night. I mean, she saw, one of the soldiers said, that was the Son of God. I mean, she's seen all of this stuff, but she's so upset that he's gone. Somebody has killed those Roman soldiers, rolled the stone away, taken the royal seal off, and now they folded up his clothes, and they left two dudes with angel wings sitting here. But it gets worse. No. Angels, when you're emotional, angels don't matter. But not just that. Listen, then she turns around. Or I don't know where to put her. At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't realize it was Jesus. When you are super emotional, you have no clue what's going on around. You don't know when you're angry. You ever do something dumb when you're angry? Never, right? I saw two people yesterday driving behind each other. One guy pulled out of the 7-Eleven. This truck almost hit this van. So the truck got mad and then tried to kill the guy for cutting him off for 3 seconds. Didn't hit him, didn't do anything, but wanted to kill him. Why? Because he got angry. Suddenly he thought, I should kill that person. What is wrong with us? Have you driven on Grissom lately? I mean, right? What is US 1? What is wrong? Because anger, anytime our emotions overwhelm us, we don't think clearly. Listen, at this she turned around and she saw Jesus, but didn't realize it was Jesus. He asked her, I love this, woman, why are you crying? Once again, he knows the answer. Who is it you're looking for? Thinking he's the gardener. So here's her whole process. So I know you've been like trimming roses this morning. And you know, I know you were probably here and you saw the roses, you killed the Roman soldiers, you took this giant stone that can't be moved by one person, and you, the gardener, who's cutting rose bushes, rolled it away, you went in, folded up his clothes, left two dudes in there with angel wings, and where'd you put him? That's what she said. She said, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you put him, and I'll go get him. Jesus said, I love this, Mary. She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. Let me tell you something awesome about God. No matter how much you struggle with emotions, whether it's anger or frustration or bitterness or hurt or unforgiveness, or you're perplexed or you don't understand God, or whatever's happened in your life, just one word from God can change you. But you have got to own it and say, God, I need you. When's the last time you said, God, I don't even know where I'm at. Would you help me? Number two, we need to own our doubt. God's okay with doubters. I'm okay with doubters. You come here to church today, somebody might have dragged you here, and maybe you don't believe in God. That's okay. You may have questions. That's okay. I'm not against questions. I'm not one of these pastors that's going to yell at you for asking questions. Jesus didn't either. Listen, now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came, so the other disciples told him, we've seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hand and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side. Now he was ticked, obviously, because he's thinking these guys that he traveled with Jesus, are lying to him. All these, they've seen Jesus do miracles, they've seen Jesus walk on water, they saw Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead, and now they're telling him, we saw Jesus, and he's like, no, you didn't. And not only did you not, you bring him here, and I'll put my fingers where we saw him crucified, and stick my hand in him. It's disgusting, right? Why? Because he's ticked. Listen to these words. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. So think about this. For a week, Thomas is meeting with the disciples and he's saying, I don't believe you. And you can almost see Jesus leaning in at the door going, nah, he's not ready yet. And then one day, the disciples are there. Remember, they're afraid they might be arrested. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Jesus appears and says, peace. And I bet you it was the least peaceful peace ever, because they probably went, peace. Yeah, right? I mean, I can't imagine that they went, oh, it's good to have you here. Hey, thanks for coming back. You know, I mean, if we were in the room and all of a sudden some dude was standing right here, like out of nowhere, would you go, oh, that's kind of neat? No, you'd get, right? And so Jesus stands among them, peace, you know, right? And freaks them out. Jesus never rejects doubters. But sometimes he allows us to walk through adversity. Sometimes he allows us to walk through our questions. Sometimes he allows us to struggle with that time where we wonder where God is to strengthen our faith. And I want you to know it's okay to say, Lord, I have doubts. Lord, there's some things I don't understand. Lord, I have hurts I don't want to face. I have pain I don't want to face. I have emotions I don't want to face. I have things that I don't understand. Would you help me with my doubt? And then finally, number three, we need to move forward in faith to own our next choice. I'm going to talk about this at length next week. The idea that not only do we need to own it, then we need to learn to move forward, to forgive. But here's what I want to talk about. Jesus says this. Then he said to Thomas, you want to put your finger there? Put your fingers there. See my hands? Reach out your hand. Put it in my side. Jesus calls his bluff. Says, okay, if that's really what you think, I'm going to show you. Stop doubting and believe. And poor Thomas, when we get to heaven, we're going to walk up to him and he's going to say, we're going to say, what's your name? He's going to say, Thomas. We're going to be like, are you doubting Thomas? And he's going to be like, hey, that was one time, thousands of years ago. And I got a t-shirt that says it on it, but it's not funny anymore. Would you guys quit that? You know, right? So we're going to get to heaven and be like, Doubting Thomas! And I'm like, oh, never live that down. Then he turns around and he says, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, because you've seen me, you believe. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. It's okay to doubt, but don't let your doubt go. Wrestle with your doubt. If you're here today and you don't believe in God, I want to encourage you to do what I've encouraged many atheists over the years to do. Hey, I don't believe in God. And then I say, okay, well then pray that the God that you don't believe in will begin to reveal himself to you. And they're like, good, I'm going to have him throw one of my enemies down the stairs. I'm like, no, that's not what I mean. Ask God in your heart to show you that he's real. Don't tell him what to do. He's not a genie. You don't get to rub a lamp and get three wishes. You say, God, if you're real, you show me you're real. Years ago, there's a guy who goes to our church now actively on Saturday nights. Years ago, he was a teacher, and we were talking one day, and he knew I was a pastor, and he said, you're a pastor, huh? And by the way, if you're a pastor, is followed by huh, that's never a good, just so I've learned over the years, that's never, you're a pastor, huh? Look out. That's like duck. You might as well just say, duck, here it comes. So I love to get on planes, and people sit down, and they go, so what do you do for a living? I'm a pastor. I put on their headphones immediately. It's like, awesome. So yeah, it's great at weddings, too. People invite me, oh, you need to come to a wedding, sit at the table. So who are you? I'm the pastor. So this guy says to me, you know, I don't believe in God. And he goes on with all the things he doesn't believe and starts asking me questions. And I challenged him with what I challenged you with. And later he came to me and said, you know, I just see the order of the universe. I see the sunrise, blah, blah, blah. I believe in God. I just don't believe in Jesus. So then I started telling him what Jesus said. And he started asking me questions. And I talked about the different proofs of Christ and the textual proof and the historical proof and the eyewitness proof and even Herodotus and all these other people. So I began talking to him that little by little. And one day, and I said, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And I said, Jesus was either crazy, C.S. Lewis said, or he was who he said he was. I said, if he was crazy, he wouldn't have acted the way he acted. But if he was who he said he was, we should believe in him. And one day this guy came back to me and said, I gave my life to Christ, and I was able to baptize him and part of his family. And it was neat to see what God did, take somebody from not believing at all to faith in Christ, to somebody who now serves actively in church, and I see life change. He's got two kids now, and I see life change. And I look at my life, and I look at the lives of others. The disciples went to their graves believing in what they saw. But I believe because of what I've seen, what I've seen God do in my life and other lives. But I want you to know something. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, if you're not ready to give your life to Christ today and you have doubts, I want you to know that's okay. My email is on the back of the bulletin. My phone number is in there, the church phone number. I have a Facebook account. You can send me notes. If you're good at smoke signals, I've been getting a lot of smoke signals lately, apparently. And I don't care how you ask me, but you ask me anything you want. I'll be glad to answer any question that you have. Sometimes my answer will be, oh no. But I'll do my best to answer any question you have, because here's the deal. I don't think God minds doubt. He just doesn't want you to give up. So don't quit going after God and saying, God, I'm not sure if I believe in you, or I'm not sure about this, or I'm not sure about that. Listen, God's okay with that. But don't quit pursuing that. But if you're here today and you're ready to give your life to Christ, I'll be here after the service and you can come and say, Eric, on Easter Sunday, I want to give my life to Christ today. Maybe you're here today and you're a believer, and the truth for you is that there was a moment where your life changed. Something happened. And whatever it is, whether it's forgiveness, or whether it's bitterness, or whether it's you didn't want to own up to something that you did, I want to encourage you today to go back to that moment and say, God, I want to make that moment right so that the rest of your days can be full of joy and peace and gratitude for what God has done and is doing in your life. I'll be here after the service if you need prayer. We're going to have our offering in just a minute. We're going to pray now. Would you join me as we pray? Father, I thank you for Easter Sunday that reminds us that imperfect, messed up, broken people are forgiven because of your love. And Father, not only do you forgive us, but you take folks who inwardly are dead or dying through all kind of means, Father, and you give us new life through your Spirit and through your Word. Father, I thank you that you heal us emotionally. You heal our emotions when we can't even see straight. And Father, you work in our doubts. And Lord, even after we've blown it, when we admit, just like the thief on the cross, when we admit that we need you, we surrender to you, you say you've won. So Father, today I pray if there's anyone here who's never surrendered their life to you, that today would be the day they surrender to you and receive your grace. Help us to own it. Help us to own our part in sin, to understand that we don't have it together. But Father, to know that you are good, and we trust you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Have our time of offering now. You just give what God's put on your heart today. Thanks for coming today. I'll be here after the service.